So you're good?
I am awesome.
You are awesome. Everything is awesome. The world is awesome. Are you in awesome mode? Are you like, is everything just, you're still shooting, aren't you?
I'm shooting. I mean, I have just finished the third part of a film that is long and intense and good. But I have just returned 1 day and a half ago. And it's raining in LA and I love it. It smells good. The soil, and I'm fine. I'm a little exhausted. I need to rest because the shooting has been very intense. But I'm very happy.
The third part of the shoot is the last part of the shoot? You're done?
No. I still have two-thirds to go.
Two-thirds to go. Oh, the first third you're done.
Exactly, the first third.
Good lordy. And you're all in Tom Hardy and Leo? Is that
Leo
the...
and Tom Hardy. And so there's a lot of other bunch of guys. It's a gang. It's a tribe of savages. And we are maybe shooting a very remote, beautiful places with intense weather changing all the time. So the conditions and the geography is tough, but it's a journey. It's a once in a lifetime adventure, I have to say.
It sounds like a completely different universe than you've ever.
That's why I did it. That's why it attracts me. 3-4 years ago, that I start involving myself in this project. Then I rewrote it with Mark Smith. But I think the universe of it is so unique, and it gives a lot of opportunities to explore. And let's see what can be done against the storms and blizzards. You know.
Well, what's the worst that could happen?
Die. Be eaten by a bear. They will spit my Mexican flesh. Spicy.
Has there ever been a director eaten by a bear?
That would be fantastic. It would be a headline.
That would be a big headline.
Exactly.
For at least a week.
Exactly. I will be the man of the 15 minutes on Thursday.
It is psychotic, isn't it? That it just like the cycle just does not stop.
Exactly.
Every day it's another thing.
It's a joke. It's funny.
Who the hell knows what it's going to be next? So we talked to Antonio Sanchez. Also in the time since I saw you last. And I had no idea that you were a radio DJ and that's how that relationship started. But tell me about that. Tell me about being a DJ.
I'm a frustrated musician. I had a band. I studied guitar. I played the drums in a band. So I wanted to be a musician. And then I go into college and I was not a good student, never. And a 18-year-old guy went into direct radio station who was kind of abandoned, and he started inviting people from the college. He was not in the college. The girlfriend of this guy was with me, and she liked my voice and said, "Do you think you would like to do a cast?" And I said, "Why?" "Well, for a radio." I said, "Well, I never imagined radio, but let's see." So I went, I did the thing, and I was accepted. And Martin Hernandez, which is my sound design for all my life of all the films, he wanted to go there. He was the first one to tell me, they are doing a cast here. So I said, I'm sorry, but I have been accepted. And he was rejected. So I talked to this 18-year-old guy and said, can you, I was 19-year-old, can you take my friend with me? So anyway, we went both together there. We were doing short films in the college. He was the sound boom guy. I was the musician of the short films. I was an assistant director and a musician. So we were there, and we start this radio station that was WFM 96.9 radio. and basically, I was more like a host, because in that time was LB. I was just playing the music that I wanted. So I have a show from 12 to 3 p.m. daily. And it became to be very successful. And Martina and I began to do what really was cool about the radio station is that what really the reason the people hear that radio station was for the things that happened between songs. We start doing, very funny characters and political things attacking the government and invented realities and stories of turkeys that in Christmas kill people in the dinner Christmas. Stupid things produced with audio. Martin was absolutely a incredible technician to that, cutting the one quarter thing, and maybe you are younger than me, and maybe you have, but it was unbelievable, and we began to get, and anyway, long story short, 2 years after I became the director of that radio station, I was, we became very famous, and we were number one for 5 years doing this, and the beautiful thing is that I arrived, and it was like a therapy for me, because I get my favorite music, jazz, classical music, rock, commenting things. So if I was mad, I complain. If I was sad, I was just like that. And you get the call from this teenager that she was in love with you. You know what I mean? It was like a very, like, it was like an open therapy session. And it was beautiful. It was beautiful. I really enjoyed it. It was very creative. And for me, I would say storytelling-wise, to maintain an audience for 3 hours as you are putting music with rhythm, with beats, with comments, with that, I think I learned a lot of that, to communicate ideas and things, you know.
Did you want to be a performer? Did part of you want to be a performer?
I would have loved. But I my fingers are clumsy enough to not be a good guitar player, and I would never feel reliable on that. I thought that I was a good composer, abstract composer, and I did like five music for films, for Mexican films, but I was not a good performer, and anyway, my life took me to other places.
And acting, not so much, or?
No, I'm a terrible actor.
Well, apparently you performed on radio.
Yeah, but it's another thing. My eyes cannot sustain a lie. I'm a terrible. My wife said you are a terrible actor. She always catches me in the first one. I'm terrible to lie. I'm very stupid, so I can't. So I'm a terrible performer. But anyway, I'm directing films. My father always said you know what happened when you don't study. That's what you are doing, a film director. So I deserve it.
There are worse things you could do, I guess.
Exactly.
So I mean, was there pressure? I mean, what was the transition from being a successful radio guy, because those are always in demand, there's always somebody out there willing to give you a living, certainly, and becoming a full-time director?
Well, when I was directing, honestly, there was a moment that we were now already in the fifth year of incredible success. Martin and I were kind of popular in that time there, and I was starting not to enjoy what I was doing, because I didn't want to be a DJ all my life, and I love films, and I suddenly began to realize that I want to be a filmmaker, like when I was 21 or something like that, and I was just looking for an opportunity. So I decided to jump into this same friend of mine now, the guy who was the director, jump into a TV thing. So he invited me to start doing some TV things. So I began to do this kind of same pieces of creativity that were kind of shaking ideas or things like that to identify the channel. So I jumped into literally start writing ideas, and with a partner, we opened a production company and we start writing, directing from nothing. Simultaneously, I went into a theater. I started to study theater with the genius of theater there that was called Ludwig Margulis. And I studied 3 years theater as I opened my own production company. So it was a great period for me, because I was this guy was a master of minimalism, pushing us, destroying life, the most incredible motherfucker ever. Like the guy from Whiplash, like that, kind of those kind of really tough guys. And so I was, you know, in a way learning from that. At the same time that I was doing my little first attempts to direct something. And it was a great school, combination of what I was learning, I was applying here. And then we opened this kind of production company. We started doing short films, producing documentaries, a lot of advertising. So I began to get a lot of time in the sets, directing an incredible amount of commercials. But beautiful enough, I was not directing commercials for products, but it was more like an identity for the channel.
So like the MTV bumper kind of thing?
Yeah, exactly. So it was about emotions, like Father's Day, Mother's Day, Christmas. So it was from 5 seconds to 2 minutes. So always I was writing it, editing, you know, so I was learning. It was like the best university ever. Before I direct Amores Perros, I had already 10 years in the sets, directing every format, everything, learning the camera, learning the lights. I mean, literally producing, directing, writing, editing. And that was a huge school for me in that sense, at least the craft, you know, the craft about.
So is any of that material worth looking at now? I mean, is it any of it going to show up in a reel someday?
I think there's some things. You know, I start doing a lot of, you know, I have done some commercials that I feel, you know, lucky to have done. I did one commercial that was very successful in 2001, the BMW series, the first one that was short films. Five directors were invited to that, and I did one that was called Powder Keg with Stellan Skarsgård and Clive Owen driving. It was the starting of Clive Owen.
Right.
It's a piece of 6 minutes that is very brutal in the Latin American war. I have done a couple of Nike commercials, big one, like the World Cup Soccer. That was a big one four years ago that I feel good. I did one.
But none of the stuff when you were like a kid, you were doing these bumpers or whatever.
I think there's things that really, in a way, maybe they look naive, but there was some very, I was in the minimalistic thing. My teacher always looked, Big Margulis always was telling me, if you are not capable to convey reality and trigger people emotion with just a black screen without any element, but just with the truth, fullness and honestly of the performance and the material that you are portraying with your actors, you should not direct. You cannot have that title of being a director. So he was always pushing to us to the minimalistic, very polished theater. And so there was a big campaign about just basically white screen with some elements that it was just a little vignette of a very powerful, simple idea that I think that campaign was interesting. You know, I think I can see it now, and I can say it, obviously it looks maybe like shit, but the bottom of it, it was solid. I think those exercises were really good for me. You know.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because we talk to people and they carry the memory of the work they've done almost more than they look at the movie or whatever it is later, and there's something intimate about it, and something kind of the thing you took away from it is almost as valuable as the work sometimes, I think.
What do you mean? The
any work that you do, really. I mean, is that...
No, I'm lucky that I went through all these. I think radio... I always said that radio and production and advertising always were kind of... And when I was doing it, I was conscious and aware that... I call it the rivers. Like the rivers that will get me through the ocean. And I knew that film was where I want to arrive, but I knew that before I took my sails and navigate in the ocean of film, in order to not sink, I need to really, really learn how to really maneuver the sails and the ship, you know. So in a way, when I arrived to the opportunity to go to the ocean, I knew how to manage that thing. I think thanks to those rivers, I learned a lot of things, and they give me a lot of experience. So I don't regret none of that. I think all of that was incredibly useful. That's why I'm saying radio, I think, is an incredible, beautiful tool of narrative imagination without need of money. Honestly, it's just, you can go as far as anything without money, so it's great.
Well, now we have YouTube for that, so.
Sorry?
Now we have YouTube and podcasts and all that.
That's, I think, what this generation is really taking advantage amazingly. So, I mean, there's a lot of shit, but there's beautiful things. Yeah. You know, there's these sites, Nowness, and all those sites that present these short films of kids around the world, and it's an incredible opportunity to express that. It's kind of the radio, the visual radio of today, and it's an archive of human experiences and visual things that are fantastic, and that those are great tools to do a film. You know?
So before we get out of the past completely, how did the Three Amigos thing happen? Because I never really understood where that started.
The Three Amigos thing, the first one I met was Guillermo del Toro. When I was editing Amores Perros, my first film, I edit myself in the house. I have a studio. I was living in the woods in Mexico, and I have a studio that I built. That it was great, and I spent 7 months there. And I was very, 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 very close to finish that film, but being multi-structure, and it was my first film narratively, I have some doubts about it. And so a friend of mine, Antonio Ruti, another filmmaker, knew Guillermo del Toro. And he said, you should send this to Guillermo del Toro to help you, to give your opinion. Guillermo already has direct other films. So I sent it to him through Antonio Rutia. And I swear to God that that's the story. Literally, 6 a.m., I receive a call. Negro, negro, es increíble. Está poca madre, cabrón, poca madre. Who is Guillermo del Toro? Well, I have some ideas. I said, what ideas? I think the second story you should take it out. And I say, what? The second story doesn't work. I think it doesn't work. You just stay with the first one and the third one. I said, what? So he started explaining to me why. And I said, you're crazy. I was offended. I was like, what? Your kid is beautiful. Just cut the leg. The left leg is horrible. I said, what do you mean? It will not walk without it. And anyway, we went in a heat discussion. I said, well, I challenged him. I said, well, if you want to tell me that, come here. It's very easy to say, take it out. No, you come and I will prove you that you can do that. Mm. Okay, I will go. I'm going tomorrow. He was in Guadalajara. Huh. Next day, I opened the door. I saw that guy that big with like childish eyes. He went and jumped directly to the refrigerator, eat everything in my house, my kids' food. We went down to the studio, and we spent like 3 days together, beautiful, funny days, where he was really just trying to do things, you know, proposing me things. And I bought some things, I bought not some things, but he helped me to get down the film like maybe 6-7 minutes, which were incredibly interesting and very powerful. I think his comments really shaped me a lot. I mean, teach me a lot and helped me a lot to understand how a film can be tight and more effective, and you know. So he helped me a lot. And I didn't take the second story for, of course.
Thank God.
But thanks God. But anyway, that was the thing. And from then, we became friends. And since then, each other see the cuts of each other. Mm. Since then. So every time that I finish, he see my cut, I see his cuts. And always is kind of a commitment to help each other to do comments. So it has been a beautiful relation. Mm. And Alfonso, I met him here. By the way, after the radio, before I did anything, I wrote a TV series, like a 1-hour episode for the TV. That was my first job as a storytelling. Mm. So I did it in film, and it was air. But I was trying to do a film, but I didn't know exactly how to start, how to produce it, who, you know, it was another world. So I came to visit Alfonso, who was already, he was about to start Great Expectations. He was sitting in the Chateau Marmont. He was Alfonso Cuarón. So I said, Mr. Alfonso, how are you? And nothing, I just give him the tape, the VHS of Detrás del Dinero, Behind the Money, it was called. And I said, take a look, and some commercials, and I said, you know, you don't know who I am, just take a look. This was 94, I think, or 95. Take a look, blah, blah. And incredibly, the guy was already a Hollywood director with Little Princess and all that. And he called me the next morning very early. I don't know why they wake up so early.
Everybody wakes up early.
They were drunk or they were hangover. I don't know, but they called me very early. I remember that. And he was on and on and how much he loved it. So really, he was on and on. And one thing that I know, that now I know, is that Chivo Lubezki, that who I have been doing some commercials with him before I met Alfonso, Chivo told him, I met the Mexican guy that you should know him. I think this guy is going to be, he always laugh about me. You know, say, come on, these guys, they don't know what they're doing. Always he was, now I know, this is an information that I knew 20 years later. So then anyway, when I give him that, he really was very generous. And from there, I start visiting him in the set of Great Expectations and ask him for some guidance. So I think in a way, I think Alfonso and Guillermo has been great mentors and has guided me and has helped me and has embraced me and has, you know, has been a friendship that has been so valuable in the affectionate level and intellectual and professional. Mm. So we have been already friends for a lot, and I'm very lucky.
You know? Well, the ongoing success of all three of you is kind of a remarkable thing.
Well, I think they are accusing us that we are waterboarding every member of the Golden Globes and critics, but I don't know.
No, you're keeping Chivo to yourself, is the thing. <You're> like,
no, I think that, we have been, you know, we have been working hard, and something that is very beautiful is that, you know, if you see all the best films of Fellini or the great directors, always there's 3-4 writers, right? And they were very close friends, you know, all the Italians in that period that I love. And I think the camaraderie that we have created it is not only, it's obviously it's about affection and about great friendship, but the same, we are very honest and we help us to shake each other, our structures of certainty and without fear. And that, I think, is a valuable tool. Because if you ask somebody else, everybody has their agendas or whatever, but when you ask to a people that doesn't have any other interest to really help you from the right side of the heart, is incredibly valuable, I think. That.
And who really knows what they're talking about also.
I think so, yeah.
I mean, you're all three very different as filmmakers, but yet all three incredibly accomplished and, you know, skillful.
But that's why I think we take advantage of each other, because if we will be similar, maybe we will not, you know, we'll not give nothing back. But I think coming from different styles of things, I think that's very, very, very helpful. No, I think that's a lucky thing. That's a coincidence. I mean, I think we are lucky to belong to the same generation and has shared some belong to the world community of filmmakers and has been living in this time and being friends. I think that's a lucky thing.
So you were happy to be going back to work when you were, we last talked, because you wouldn't have to spend your time worrying about all this mania around the award season. Has that worked out kind of the way you wanted it to, or is it?
Yeah, honestly, it's great. Because, you know, the thing is, I think all this thing, I'm always a little bit distant about it, because I'm doubtful, because sometimes I feel, first of all, thankful. So, I mean, honestly, I'm incredibly thankful, because I never thought that this laboratory experiment of the unknown and this thing that I was trying to do, it will not only be made, but being like or resonate in so many people in the way it has been. I have never received so many, in a way, mails of affection and love for the film than any other film. I'm very surprised, from people that really I admire. And that made me very, very happy, you know, and so thankful about that. Now, all this craziness of the who wins, who not, or that, I always feel that is largely undeserved, because, you know, no, I don't know if somebody deserves to be recognized for something that is so incredible, privileged to do. And at the same time, you know, you become from being nominated to a loser, and I'm an expert on that. So suddenly, without doing nothing, you are like improvised winner, loser in a very frenetic, bipolar way.
Yeah.
So I think always it's a coin of two heads. But at the bottom line is that being working away has been helping me to not be in the ego trip that is very dangerous, which that's what the film is about. And not being aware of the praise, whatever, I think it's more healthier, you know what I mean? I cannot change the film anymore. I did that, and that's what it is, you know?
You haven't seen the film since you did that?
Well, I saw pieces of it, because we were dealing with the color correction of the DVD. So, yeah, Chivo and I in Calgary, we sit down. But we didn't see the whole film. We were just seeing, like, the key elements for the color and revise things, yeah.
And is Chivo in the next film also?
Yeah.
It's a gimmick.
Yeah.
But I mean, he's the most mysterious man in Hollywood these days. Everybody is trying to figure out how to get Chivo on camera.
His wife do things the same. No, he's just very shy about it, you know what I mean? Again, he has this thing about, it's tough to talk about your work, is what it is, and I think he felt that. I think he has now been navigating through that, and I think he can get away with that, and I think it's fine. I think someday he will come out from the closet. But no, he's a lovely and incredible guy. You know?
It's kind of remarkable to think that he's a front runner again for another. He's kind of the front runner to win the Oscar again this year.
I think he did an amazing job. You know, I think that the thing with Chivo is that not only I will say that it's not the technical aspect of it, because in this film particularly there were not a lot of technical things or tricks or things that were high tech. So, no, there was no CGI or there was no budget for it. I think the thing
is, but no screwing up. That was a big one.
No, I will say that something that I feel very proud about, I think we did, was like, I think just from the concept of just being doing something that it's such an internal concept, the voice in ourselves, the ego, it basically bring a parallel reality that is internal, is intellectual perception. And obviously to try to achieve that reality, blending with the real events of the character's life, I knew that it has to be that continuous shot. But more than the technical achievement was how to approach it, how to execute it, and how to make that not a technical trick, which was not, but more like an extension of the emotional state of this guy cinematically, and that's what I feel. I think, you know, this collaboration narratively and visually blended to bring that. And Chivo's, I think from our generation, we have been saying, Alfonso and I, that from our generation, Chivo, I think, is artistically one of the most incredible guys in our generations, because he's only not only obviously technically capable, but he's a poet. You know what I mean? I think he didn't use any film light. It was only practical light. So what I'm saying is, I think he's a special guy. You know?
It's kind of a great time for DPs with him and Deakins, and Bradford Young is kind of coming up, and it's some pretty great DPs out there working these days. I guess there always have been, but we're talking about them more.
Yeah, no, but I think nowadays, I think there's great guys out there. I think there's incredible guys doing fantastic things, you know.
So you're just in for a little while, and then you'll start again after the holidays?
Yes, I just came. I have just arrived yesterday. I will be basically a couple of days, and then I leave to Mexico to have some holidays and be ready to be back in the cold and the winter of Calgary.
Even colder.
Yeah. No, it will be brutal. I have to be honestly. I have to be preparing physically and mentally, because it's not for a tropical banana man as me to be in the winter. When light is gone at 3 p.m., it's psychologically, the impact is brutal, I have to say. But anyway, I came here and I'm very happy by the way the film go, and I feel very proud about it, I have to say. I'm absolutely surprised of what has happened with the film so far. So,
and you get a couple of days off to wear a tuxedo and in the warmth, and then go back to the crazy.
Exactly. Yeah. No, I'm very happy to be working in this other film. I have to say, very, very happy. Birdman was a laboratory, something that I have never done, and it was kind of betting in the unknown and pushing unprecedented thing. That it was scary. This one, I think, it's another kind of animal. And Chivo and I has been like really dealing with an animal that we never measure. But when you are confronting with weather and animals and things like that, you are like, fuck, this is not LA anymore.
Or Mexico City.
Exactly.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.